It's about 1,000 years since God has given the law to Moses. Over 400 years before the birth of Christ. And due to the disobedience of Israel to God's command, well, they have found themselves in a mess. The nation of Israel is destitute. The people have been held in bondage through Israel's disobedience. It brought about the division of the kingdom, first separating into north and south, becoming weakened by not being united. Well, the Assyrians came in and took over the northern kingdom. Not too many years after that, the Babylonians come in and they take out Judah, the southern area, Jerusalem itself, and haul off the people into bondage. The Babylonians, when they conquered, well, they had a tendency to go into an area and they deported every person that was indigenous to the area. The Jews, almost en masse, if not all, most of all, wind up being deported to Babylon. They're uprooted. They're moved over into this new place so that there's no more unity. And while in Babylon, well, during this 70-year period, they start assimilating. They start becoming more like the Babylonians. Generations are born, people are born into this place of captivity. And in so doing, they wind up settling down. They wind up maybe still worshiping the God of their fathers, but certainly doing it from a Babylonian bent. Oh, no longer able to sacrifice, no longer able to worship in the temple, which now lays in waste in Jerusalem. The people have either little hope or desire to return to the land that God had promised them. Oh, Israel's still a people group. They're still identifiable as Jewish, the Jewish and God-chosen nation. But without a homeland, those that have been deported, well, they're starting to be assimilated, starting to be absorbed into other cultures. Among them, though, some had even risen to prominence within the Babylonian Empire. We know that, well, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. We know that Esther was made a queen within the courts of the king of Persia. But at the same time, while they were certain those that were rising to prominence, there were also those that still considered their position and their plight to be one of captivity. After 70 years of captivity in Babylon, the Persian Empire comes in and liberates them, if you will, by becoming the new ruler, the new empire in charge. And it gives the Jews the opportunity to return to the homeland. At this time, somewhere between 2 to 3 million Jews occupying the area in Babylon. Given the opportunity to return, Zerubbabel, one in the line of David, one that would go back, not necessarily as a king, but certainly as a governor of the people, musters as many as he can, and a whopping 2% of the 2 to 3 million, 50,000, decide that it's worth the journey to go back and to bring about the restructuring, the rebuilding of the temple in order that they may worship their God in the way that they had been prescribed. During this time, shortly after, the prophet Ezra leaves with another smaller contingency of 2,000, being that which brings not now the governmental component of Zerubbabel, but the priestly component through Ezra into the area to help to finish the project. But while they continue in the process of finishing the temple, Israel itself, the city, Jerusalem, lies still in waste. This book of Nehemiah begins 15 years after the close of the book of Ezra. And we just finished Ezra, but understand, in the Hebrew scripture, the book of Ezra and Nehemiah are one book. They're contained and should be seen as companions continuing in the story. It's almost 100 years now after the first captives were sent back to the promised land. Jerusalem has laid in waste for well over 150 years, completely is destroyed. And now, even though the temple has been rebuilt, the walls are still down. The gates are still burned. Israel is now a shadow of its former self. A small remnant had managed to return, but they had failed miserably to secure the city. And still outnumbered now by their enemies, they lead what is a very tenuous, a very anxious, a very difficult life. It tells us in the first chapter, the first verse of Nehemiah, that the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hachaliah, came to pass in the month of Chislev. In the 20th year, I was in the Shushan, the citadel, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came with the men from Judah. And I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, "The survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire." So now we have the introduction to this man, Nehemiah. The first thing that we see about Nehemiah, the first thing we learn is that he holds a pretty high position, one that will be identified in just a few verses. But he holds a position, and we can see that based on where he's located. He's in the citadel. The citadel, well, that's just a fancy word for the secure palace of the king of Persia. He's living in some pretty good digs. He's got a pretty good job. And he says that it's in the month of Chislev. That's December on our calendars. He says that he had a conversation with one of his brothers about the people who had left 100 years before going to Jerusalem. He wanted to know how they were doing. How is Jerusalem coming? How are they faring there? And it's interesting because they're referred to those who escaped or survived the captivity. Now, when we look at somebody in a place of prosperity, very seldom do we refer to them as escapees or survivors. They weren't prospering at this particular point in time. If anything, they were barely holding on because they're in this place of great distress. Great distress, why? Well, the city has no walls. The city has no walls. A city that is unwalled is undefendable. A city that is unwalled in this particular time in history was seen to be almost irrelevant. It was a place to where anyone that wanted to with superior force could walk in and take whatever they wanted because there was no security. It would be like your home having no doors and you leave on a regular basis and anybody that just felt like it could walk in and could walk out. Now, we know that even doors and locks don't keep out committed thieves from coming in and getting it, but a walled city had the opportunity to provide protection. Now, after being in Israel and walking on the top of the walls around Old Jerusalem and being able to see, I understand now how it works. When they talk about the gates and they talk about the ability, when you're on top of a wall that's 6 or 10 feet wide and it's 30 or 40 feet high, you can see where that would slow down the average criminal. But the wall's broken down. There's great big gaps. The gates, it says, have been burned with fire. And because of this, there's no way in the world that Jerusalem is going to prosper because anything that would prosper would soon be stolen, would soon be taken. It says in verse 4, "So it was when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven." The next thing that we learn about Nehemiah is that his heart was for the Lord. Is that not only was his heart for the Lord, his heart was for his people and for his land. Now, it's pretty clear that Nehemiah would have never been at this particular time ever in Jerusalem. He was born in captivity. He was born under Persian rule, had grown up in that environment, held a position within the king's court, but he still had this heart for Jerusalem. He still had this heart for God's people. And it says, "When I heard that they were not faring well, that it caused me this great distress. I mourned within my soul. I started fasting and I started weeping over the fact that Israel and Jerusalem laid in waste." You know, something that is absolutely amazing, and you cannot explain this in human terms, and you would have to look into this a little bit, but you'll understand it when you see it, that those that are of Jewish descent, those that are Hebrew, that are Israelis, have got something that God has placed in their heart when it comes to Jerusalem. They can't even articulate why it is, but it's like because they are Jewish, it's like they need to go or have a desire to be in Jerusalem. And that's why in this recent time, over the last 50 or 75 years, we've seen this incredible influx of those going back to the promised land. They're being drawn back. And guys, it's really very simple. It's the land where God has placed his name, calling the people who are the people of God to return. And it's amazing. While we were there, it was incredible. There's all of these IDF soldiers, all right? And they're almost all young. I didn't see any. Matter of fact, they're young because there's a mandatory service. Every woman within Israel that is there and is a citizen does 2 years in the military. Doesn't matter. Every male does 3. And so you see these young, and they look like high school kids. They look like my daughters here walking around in full military gear, sporting an AR-15 or something of that nature, and they're all decked out and everything else, and you're like, wow, this is crazy. And you go up and you talk to them. Now, some of them are Israelis born in Israel, born there. Some of them are from San Diego and L.A. They're Valley girls. We ran into a couple in a store up in the Golan Heights, and we're there and we said, where are you guys from? Oh, I'm from San Diego. Oh, I'm from L.A. It's like, what are you doing here? Well, we just came to do our two-year service in the Israeli army. We're Jewish. And they can't explain it, but there was something that just called them to go back. And this is what's happening in the heart of Nehemiah. He's never seen it. The only thing he would have known about Jerusalem was what he would have heard, what he would have been told, what he would have read. He'd never been there. It's like you hearing about you. How many in here trace your ancestors back to somewhere in Europe or another country that you've never been to? All right? All of my folks came out of Ireland and Germany. Although it would be neat to be there, I have no real aching desire to go there. I mean, it's not like, oh, I've got to go there before. It's like, no. It's like, that's cool. If I got a chance to go and somebody bought me a ticket, I'd probably go. But not so here. And so Nehemiah is being called. Nehemiah also is a man of prayer. And we're going to see that prayer is at the heart of this man's life, that everything that he does, he operates in this atmosphere, in this attitude, in this conversation with God. And he starts right here in verse 5. It says, "And I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant and mercy with those who love you and observe your commandments, please let your ear be attentive and your eye be open, that you may hear the prayer of your servants, which I pray before you now, night and day. I pray for the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which have sinned against you. Both my father's house and I have sinned. We have acted very corruptly against you, and have not kept your commandments, the statutes nor the ordinances which you commanded your servant Moses. Remember, I pray, that the word that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. But if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out to the farthest part of the heavens, yet I will gather them from there and bring them to the place which I have chosen as the dwelling for my name. Now, these are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great power and your strong hand. Oh, Lord, I pray, please let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desires to fear your name, and let your servant prosper this day. I pray and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer." An amazing prayer by Nehemiah. I think that it's so interesting that Nehemiah takes responsibility for the sin of an entire nation. I mean, I don't think I've ever prayed that way. I mean, of course, I've uttered the prayer, Lord, if your people who are called by your name, well, you know, I mean, and there's this idea that we'll pray for our nation, but I don't think I've ever gone, Lord, I'm confessing the sins of the entire nation. I mean, that takes a lot of responsibility, a lot of courage to do so. But then he goes on and says, and I'm also taking responsibility for my father's sin and for my sin. I'm willing to take and come before you and say, Lord, the problem that we have right now is that we are wrapped in and steeped in sin. But then he takes this aspect of the promises that were made to Moses. And he says, Lord, can I remind you of the promise that you made? Lord, you remember when you told Moses that if we're disobedient and if we don't follow your commands, that you'll scatter us? Well, that's kind of what happened. We've been scattered. We've been blown out to the outer edges of the world. We've been taken into captivity. But then you also, but Lord, you also said, if we return, if we come back, that you'll bring us back together. Now, I find it very, very interesting how many times in Scripture that we see that during prayers especially, that there's this tendency to remind God of what he said. Do you really think that God needs to be reminded of his promises? Probably not. Who needs to be reminded of the promises of God? Yeah. Guys, we need to live here in our prayer life. I mean, the lesson here, the thing that we're seeing here is that when we approach God in prayer, we need to approach Him because we know His promises, we're standing on His promises, we're depending on His promises, and in so doing, we are reminding ourselves as we approach Him, hey God, I remember when you said that you'll never leave me and you'll never forsake me. I remember when you said that you're my strong tower and that I can run into you. I remember that you said that no weapon that's fashioned against me will prosper. And if I abide in you, that you'll abide in me and I will have everything. I remember that. And I don't think God goes, well, when did I say that? You see, that's what happens around my house when my kids come, Dad, you remember you told me you'd buy me a car? No, I don't. See, God doesn't forget His promises. I don't remember that at all. And see, in our earthly understanding, we can relate to that because it's like, when did I say that? But see, God wants us to recall. And Nehemiah is very quick to say, Lord, do you remember? Oh, not for God's purposes, but for His purposes. And then when he gets to the final portion of this prayer, he says something very interesting too. He says, God, I need favor with him. With him, my boss, the king of Persia. Because I'm his cup bearer. It says in verse 2 here, it says, and it came to pass in the month of Nisan, in April, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, that the wine was before him, and it took the wine and gave it to the king. And now I had never been sad in his presence before. Therefore the king said to me, why is your face sad, since you're not sick? This is nothing but sorrow of heart. So I became dreadfully afraid, and I said to the king, may the king live forever. When you're afraid of somebody that's in great power, it's always good to flatter them before you say what it is that you're going to say. May the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my forefathers' tombs, lies in waste and its gates are burned with fire? Then the king said to me, well, what do you request? So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, I ask that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's tombs, that I may rebuild it. And then the king said to me, and the queen was also sitting beside him, how long will your journey be, and when will you return? So it pleased the king to send me, and I set him a time. There's a couple of really, really neat things here that I think that are happening. Is right in the middle of the king asking him, and we got to understand, the king was interested enough in Nehemiah. They had a close enough relationship based on this position of cupbearer. And see, a cupbearer was the person that sampled all of the king's food and drink. Before the king would eat, right, the food would be brought out, and they were responsible to make sure that everything was prepared properly, and the wine would come out, and the meal would come out, and there would be a portion that would be taken off of what was going to be served to the king, and the cupbearer would sample it. The cupbearer lived, then it was probably okay for the king to eat. If the cupbearer died, the king would probably refrain from eating that particular food. He was a poison taster. But he was also somebody who was really, really close to the king. He would have been around the king all the time. And so there's this understanding that most likely there was more of a personal relationship than a professional duty being fulfilled here. I think it's one of the reasons it says, oh, and the queen was there too. I think that Nehemiah, as we've seen with other servants that God has placed into positions under foreign leaders, was given favor with the king. You remember Daniel was given favor. You remember Joseph was given favor. I believe Nehemiah had favor also. And this favor extended to where there's this friendship beyond just the duty that he fulfilled in his position. I believe that there was the potential of him even being somewhat of a king's confidant because he was there all the time and communicating with the king. So much so that when he asked to be given permission to go back to Judah, the king kind of goes, well, how long are you going to be gone? I need you around here, man. I kind of like having you around. How long are you going to be gone? Now, we're going to see that he's going to be gone for 12 years. We don't know how long he said when he said, I set a time for the king. We don't know what he said, but what I do know about building projects, they take twice as long and three times the amount of money to get accomplished. So however long he told him, I'm sure it wasn't just that long. It was much longer. But what we see happening here is we see this aspect of the king giving enough attention to Nehemiah to notice that he's bummed out. And he says, I know you're not sick. This isn't a sickness. This is a sorrow of heart. So what's happening here? What's the problem? And Nehemiah says, why shouldn't I be sad? But then before he says that, It says that he offered up a prayer. Man, I think this is such a cool concept. How many times have you responded to somebody that maybe had you over a barrel? Your boss asks you a tricky question, or somebody's kind of on you, and it's a tense moment. And before you think, you say something stupid. Anybody besides me? Yeah. It's like, bleh, oops. I probably shouldn't have said that. He said he was very afraid of the king. Now, I don't know if that's a fear of reverence, if that's just a fear of letting his heart be known, or fear that this is the first time the king has ever really noticed that he's bummed out. He says, I was never unhappy before the king before. So it's almost kind of like a situation where he's like, I'm afraid the fact that the king even sees me being bummed out. I presented that which I didn't want to present. But before he answers the king, he says, I threw up a prayer. Before I spoke, I said, God, help. Tell me what I'm supposed to say. And he refers to the king and he tells him, the problem is, well, the walls are burned down. The city lays in ruin. And I want to go back and do something about it. Now, one of the other things I want you to notice, and you can kind of underline these as we go through the text. Look for the word so. Look for the word so. I love the fact that Nehemiah is one of these that just cuts right to the chase. And so he has a tendency, when he wants to transition from one thought to the next, is rather than give you a long, drawn-out dissertation and explanation of what's happening, he'll just say, so I did this, and so I did that. And so watch that as you go through, and you're going to see that he's this matter-of-fact. He's this guy that just moves from one point to the next without bringing in a lot of wasted dialogue, if you will. But there's something else that's very, very important about this particular time frame. We need to understand that this authorization that King Artaxerxes gives to Nehemiah to go back and rebuild the wall sets in motion a timeline, a prophetic timeline of the 70th week of Daniel's prophecy concerning the arrival of the Messiah. Now, we have studied this out very, very detailed in the book of Daniel. And so I'm not going to go in tonight into the very, very long and in-depth aspect. If you want to go up, you can pull it offline, you can get it from the archive, and you can find out exactly what this means. But here's what I want us to hold on to tonight. I want us to hold on to the fact that Daniel prophesied that the Messiah, that Jesus Christ, would ride into Jerusalem on the foal, on the colt of a donkey, on a given day, on a specific day, on a very specific year and time, and be revealed as the Messiah. Daniel had prophesied that from the giving of this order to return and rebuild the walls, that some 483 years would pass. That there would be 483 years that would pass from the time that Artaxerxes tells Nehemiah to go build the walls until the very day that Jesus Christ, or that the Messiah, would ride into Jerusalem. Now, we've talked about this a lot, about how it's prophecy that sets apart the Bible from any other religious writing. And guys, what you guys need to understand is that hundreds and hundreds of years before the revealing of the Messiah, that God told Daniel on this day, in this year, starting from this point, start counting. And when you get to this 485 years, when you get, or 483 years, when you get to this period of time, look on that day in that year, and the Messiah is going to ride into Jerusalem. And not only is he going to ride into Jerusalem, but he's going to do so on a donkey. And guess what? It happened. It happened exactly as it was prophesied, exactly as how God had related to Daniel. Now, we know that there are those that wanted try to dispute that by virtue of saying, well, there's no way that that was written before Daniel. It must have been another Daniel that wrote it after the fact. Well, we know that that's not the case. And we know that the record and that the archaeological finds and that the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls confirmed that it was, in fact, that which was prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years before, to the day, in the exact way, that the Messiah came in to Jerusalem. Furthermore, in verse 7 I said to the king, if it pleases the king, let letters be given to me for the governors of the region beyond the river, that they must permit me to pass till I come to Judah, and a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he must give me timber to make beams for the gates of the citadel, which pertains to the temple, for the city wall, and for the house that I will occupy. And the king granted them to give me according to the good hand of God that was upon me. Then I went to the governors in the region behind the river, and I gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent captains of the army and horsemen with me. When Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Amorite, the officials, heard of it, they were deeply disturbed that a man had come to seek the well-being of the children of Israel. Now Nehemiah is a sharp guy, and he's called by God to be this builder, but he's called to do so with an extremely savvy business and political acumen. He knows his way around the political and the governmental and the business world in relationship to getting this done. Now, we remember that it was Zerubbabel that left with 50,000. Zerubbabel, a descendant of David, would have been in the line to be the king of Judah, but instead goes in this governmental position. His task is to try to rebuild the city walls. Well, he didn't quite get it done. The politician didn't quite make it happen. So the next one that goes is Ezra. And Ezra goes, and he brings 2,000 more people, and there's a boom, and there's a help, and there's an assistance that takes place. So between Zerubbabel and Ezra, they get the temple built. They get that much of it done, but the whole rest of the project is still laying there in wait to be done. And so all of a sudden, when the politician can't get it done and when the spiritual leader can't get it done, God raises up a businessman to take over. What? Because sometimes it takes somebody with a business acumen, sometimes it takes somebody that's got a get it done kind of attitude to get in and to promote and to continue the work of what God has had. Nehemiah is a layman. He's almost to the point of being in a secular position. Although he loves the Lord, he's coming in as a businessman. He's coming in as a contractor. He's coming in as a developer in order to be able to get this work done, to organize the people in such a way that the politician couldn't do and the priest couldn't do. And now it's gonna fall into the hands of this layman that God is going to use in order to be able to complete and get the work done. You know, there's times when we need a great spiritual acumen, when we need somebody who has great spiritual discernment. There's other times when we need people who are great administrators and people that can take and look at things from a standpoint of governmental intervention. There's times when that's necessary, but then there's also times when we just need somebody that knows how to get her done. And this is what Nehemiah is going to do. And I love that around here. You know, we have that same thing around here. We have folks that have great spiritual discernment. We have folks that have the ability to organize and to completely administrate concerns and issues of the church and the things that happen around here. And we've seen that especially through the acquisition of a piece of property and the other things that God has blessed us with and this building and everything. And then there's times when it just takes somebody that says, I got this, get out of my way, I'm going to do it. And it's good to see that when it takes place. So he came to Jerusalem in verse 11. And I was there for 3 days, and I arose in the night, I and a few men with me. I told no one what my God had put in my heart to do at Jerusalem, nor was there any animal with me except the one which I rode. And I went out by night through the valley gate to the serpent well and the refuge gate. And I viewed the walls of Jerusalem, which were broken down, and its gates, which were burned with fire. Then I went on to the fountain gate, to the king's pool, but there was no room for the animal under me to pass. And I went up in the night by the valley, and I viewed the wall, and I turned back, and I entered by the valley gate, so I returned. And the officials did not know where I had gone or what I had done. I had not yet told the Jews, the priests, or the nobles, or the officials, or the others who did the work. So Nehemiah shows up, and it's really interesting because he shows great foresight in this initial approach. Now, he is coming with the authority of the king, we're going to see in time that basically he is now the governor of this region. I mean, he's given total authority. He has letters of the king that give him the authority to do anything, including raising money and being given materials not only for the building of the gates and for the work to be done, but even for his own personal. I mean, this guy's got all the authority that he needs from the king. But that's not the first thing he does. He doesn't walk into town and say, "Hey, I'm here. Here's my letters of authorization. All you guys get in line, shape up, or ship out my way or the highway." He doesn't do that. He shows up, and instead he goes out on a midnight reconnaissance run. He goes out and he goes around the city. He wants to see and he wants to survey, and he wants to be able to know what he's talking about before he goes to the nobles, before he goes to the priests, before he goes to the people. He wants to know what it is that he's up against. He wants to know what the condition is for himself by seeing it. Guys, and there's great wisdom in that. There's great wisdom in taking the time to understand what's going on and what the task is before you just simply respond and take on some sort of challenge. Then he said to them in verse 17, "You see the distress that we are in and how Jerusalem lays in waste. Its gates are burned with fire. Come and let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may no longer be a reproach." And I told them the hand of my God, which had been good upon me, and also the king's word that he had spoken to me. So they said, "Hey, let's go. Let's rise up and build." And they set their hands to this good work. But when Sanballat and Tobiah, the officials of Gerizim the Arab, heard, they laughed at us and they despised us. And they said, "What is this thing that they are doing? Will you rebel against the king?" The leaders of the Moabites and the Amorites and all of the other non-Israeli inhabitants of the land raise up against Nehemiah and literally challenge him based on what they perceive as their authority. Now, they were the governors. They were in place. They had authority to some degree by the king. They didn't recognize and realize that Nehemiah's authority exceeded theirs. And so the first thing they do is they challenge him by saying, "Hey, wait. Who do you think you are? You're going against us, which means you're going against the king. How dare you come in here and try to do something without our permission?" It's interesting because they're misrepresenting their position, and literally, when it really comes down to it, they're lying. They're claiming they have authority that they really don't have. And you know, it's interesting in our modern experience, I don't know about you, but when it comes to the political arena in today's climate, it's almost like we have to come up with another word besides lying. Lying doesn't mean anything anymore. Lying is an expected activity. It's expected from that particular species that there is going to be this perpetuation of lies and misdirection and misleading and spinning, and there's not anything that's true, and we all look at it and we go, "We know that they're lying. But those particular lies side with what I like, so I'll follow them." Or those lies are coming from the other side. So much so that they simply openly and continually call each other liars, and it's like the word has absolutely no meaning. We need to come up with a new word. We need to come up with a new understanding. But the reality is that these guys have got this aspect of trying to take and trying to spin things in such a way that they're going to continue to thwart the efforts. And this is what's been going on. This is why Zerubbabel and why Ezra have had trouble for the last 100 years, is because every time they would start to do something, these guys would come in and stir up trouble. So this is what Nehemiah has to say to them. Look at verse 20. "The God of heaven himself will prosper us. Therefore, we his servants will arise and build, but you have no heritage or right or memorial in Jerusalem." I love what Nehemiah says in response. Now, he doesn't say, "Hey, I've got special letters here from the king." He doesn't say, "I have permission from the governmental authorities." He doesn't say, "I've already pulled a permit to do this building project and you can't stop me. I've got lawyers, I've got attorneys." He says, no. Here's the deal. This is God's building project. God is doing this work, and guess what? You guys ain't got nothing to say about it. You have no hand in it. You have absolutely no right to even speak. If you've got a problem, I love being able to say this when it comes especially to the Word of God, when people will turn to me and say, "Well, who are you to say that? Who are you to say that that's how it's working?" I say, "Don't take it up with me. Take it up with God. It's not my word, it's God's word. If God's word says it, all I'm doing is agreeing with it. It's not my opinion, it's His word. You either believe it or you don't. And so if you got a problem with it, take it up with God. But I love what he says. He says, you guys ain't got nothing to do with this. You guys think you do. You're going to sue, you're going to bring your lawyers, you're going to scream, you're going to claim harassment, you're going to claim discrimination, you're going to claim all of it. But the reality is, you have no part in the inheritance of what is about to take place. As we get ready to move into chapter 3, we're going to see a very smart and industrious approach to the work. Basically, what happens in chapter 3 is that we see each and every family group is assigned a certain portion of the wall, the portion of the wall that is closest to them, that is in their area. And Nehemiah says, what we're going to do is we're going to have those in the area spread out amongst the wall and repair the wall that is directly in front of you. The wall starts getting repaired in now what is record time. And chapter 3 records all of the names and the locations of this work assignment that was taking place. And guys, we use that same approach here very often. You know, you've heard me say that many hands make light the work. When there's something to be done, when the people of God come together and they do so in mass, the work gets done really quickly. And if it's done in such a way that the assignment is made to where you understand exactly what your part is, that part, rather than being overwhelming, becomes that which is very manageable. Oh, wait a minute, you mean all I got to do is deal with the stuff that's right in front of me? And that's what Nehemiah says. And all the way through chapter 3, which we're not going to read because I could just sit there and trip over names all evening long, it identifies each one of the families, each one of the groups, and the area or the gate in which they started and what was their responsibility. And as we go through chapter 3, rather than just those seeing this list of names where the people worked on the wall, we need to realize that there's more that we can understand in how Nehemiah put this together. And what we see is we see some principles of God concerning his people, and then we also see some characteristics of Nehemiah's leadership. The first principle, well, that the need and the results of God's people working together will accomplish that which God has called them to. And how many times do we know as the people of God that God has called us to a task, but when we look at it, we think, oh my goodness, this is way too big, it's way too massive, it's way too overwhelming, we can never do it. Guys, we have a mission, we have a call for this church. You remember what it is? To reach, to teach, and to love everybody in this community. We're supposed to reach them. Now, the Lord really showed me that that reaching is not mass mailing. That it's supposed to be every hand. We're supposed to in some way, and you know what? It's almost impossible to think of. If you look at the size of the group here tonight, and this is a great group. Or you look at Sunday when the place is filled up twice between two services, and you think, oh wow, there's 300-400 people here. This is wonderful. But we got to reach the 6,000 to 10,000 people. How in the world would we do that? I mean, how in the world would we ever approach being able to go out and touch? You know what? How many people are right in front of you? What represents the portion of the wall that's in front of you? The portion of the challenge that's in front of you? Your neighbors to the left and to the right and across the street. You take care of that which is directly in front of you, and the next person will take that which is directly in front of them. And before you know it, we'll have accomplished that which God has called us to do. The other thing is that God intends his people to work together, and in doing so, we will learn to lead and to follow in the mind and in the heart of Christ. It's also important to understand that every single piece of work that people accomplished is important to the whole. Any gap in the wall, it didn't matter if 40 feet on this side of a gap and 40 feet on that side of the gap were completely walled off. If there is a hole in the middle of it, the wall is insecure. And so it means everyone that is called to the work must be willing to step up and do the portion that is theirs. And this was part of what Nehemiah did, is he made it to where there was this understanding that every family was to do their part, even through multiple generations. You see, the children learned to work by working alongside of their parents in the work of the Lord. And I think that that's incredibly important today and something that's greatly lacking in our society. But then we see some of the characteristics of Nehemiah. First off, he identified that each man, each family was accountable to their own work. That the portion of the wall that was assigned to the family, if not done, would reflect poorly on that family. And that was something that they didn't want to do. They wanted to be honorable. There was never this aspect of, well, gee, I didn't know that was my job. By assigning responsibility, he also created accountability to the work. But then Nehemiah goes just a little further, and he makes sure that everyone that was assigned work, everyone that completed work, that it was noted. That they were given credit for that which they did, so much so that their names are recorded based on exactly what it is that they accomplished. He started the work in the right priority. He went to the place of the greatest need. The greatest need in the rebuilding of the wall was the gates. It was the gates. The gates created the either impregnable security of the city, or they were the weakest point and the weakest link. Now, what's really neat is while we were there and we looked at the city gates, and we were in right inside what's called the Jaffa Gate, which would have been one of the gates that they would have rebuilt. Inside, you have to go in and you have to either turn left or right after you enter the gate in order to be able to take and get through. And the reason for that is there was a double set of gates. And if somebody was going to try to just blow right through, they couldn't do so on horseback. They couldn't do with chariots, because you had to go in and you had to literally stop, make a hard left, and then be able to go through another gate. And so this idea of rebuilding the wall started with the gates and then worked its way out on either side. And each one of these was responsible for this certain aspect, starting with and beginning with the gates. But the place that they started with the spiritual understanding. And it says that Nehemiah had the priest consecrate the work. Take and hold the work up to the Lord. And so all of these are the attributes that we see him placing into it. He also called both the nobles and the common to work together. There wasn't one of these, well, the labor force comes from the middle and lower class, and the upper class get to sit around and watch and supervise. No. Everybody got to work side by side. And then he also didn't have any restrictions on who did the work. I love the fact that they had goldsmiths and priests and perfumers working together. Now, let me ask you a question. How many folks in here do we have that are handy? I mean, you're pretty handy. Okay, good. All right. Now, if you had to build something, you know, you can kind of see your way around. It doesn't matter what it is, anything from a condominium to a chicken coop, it doesn't matter. But have you ever worked with somebody that had absolutely no mechanical acumen, had absolutely no idea of which end of a hammer to use, right? That's what I kind of see, what I think, a perfumer. Somebody that's used to making smell sauce, out there lifting rocks and building the wall, right? And so the picture of this, though, is so beautiful, because when we come together in the service of doing that which the Lord has called us to do, how often do you look at yourself and think, I'm not qualified to do that? I'm not qualified to do the work of the Lord. I'm not qualified to do something that is spiritual in nature, or I'm not qualified to do something that God would have me to do. I'm just a perfumer. I'm a goldsmith. What do I know about chiseling rocks? I work with fine gold. I'm not a carpenter. I'm not a construction guy. But yet under the leadership and under the direction of the Lord, everyone was able to and was put into a position of being able to serve. And now this brings about another point, because at the end of the day, can you imagine the pride? Can you imagine the hearts of the people as they looked and they see this wall at the end of the project completed, and every single one of them, from the heavy-duty stonemason down to the beautician, had a hand in it. From the guy that works in the grocery store to the guy that works in an office building, had a hand in the work. And see, that's the way the church is supposed to work. The way that the church is supposed to work, the people of God are supposed to work, is we're supposed to come together united under the cause of God and to do whatever it is that God has placed in front of us. And you know what? He'll bless the work and he'll make it come about in his way and in his time. But it's not good. Look at verse 1 of chapter 4. But so it happened, when Sanballat heard that they were building the wall, that he got furious and very indignant, and he mocked the Jews. And he spoke before his brethren and the army of Samaria, and he said, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they fortify themselves? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they complete it in a day? Will they revive the stones from the heaps of rubbish stones that are burned?" Now Tobiah the Ammonite was beside himself. I love that. And he said, "Whatever they build, even if a fox goes up on it, it will break down their stone wall." The enemies of God's people, whenever they see God's people prospering, they have to do something to stop them. They have to try to build some sort of effort to thwart what's going on. And one of the greatest tools that Satan uses is he uses mockery or mocking of not only the things of God, but the people of God. Satan loves to mock the people of God collectively and also individually. We see it all the time. I mean, think about the news media and how it paints and how it perverts the image of the church. Think about the movies and the television that you see it portraying the church and how ridiculous it's made to look. It's mocking the things and the people of God. But we also know that this comes on a personal level. How many times have you ever been in a situation where somebody has openly mocked your faith? Has told you that you're stupid or weak for believing in what you believe. You really believe all of that stuff? I've had people sit down and look at me after they find out that I'm a pastor and go, do you really believe that stuff? And I go, no. Of course I do. Oh, you mean you believe all of those stories in the Bible? And I said, you know what? The problem is they're not stories. They're accounts of how God has interacted in the affairs of man since the beginning of time. And not only do I believe them, but I know them to be true. Oh, come on. You telling me that Noah really put all those animals on the ark? And I go, absolutely not. God did. Amen. Noah just built the ark. And you know what's even more amazing? Noah wasn't an ark builder. He was probably a perfumer. I don't know. But he certainly wasn't an ark builder. But God used him to build an ark. And in so doing, yes, I believe that. Do you believe that there was a global flood? Absolutely. Do you believe? Yes. There are accounts in the Bible. There are God's interacting within human history and doing so in a way that reveal himself, his glory and his power. And we can stand on it and we can believe it because it's true. But mocking is one of the enemy's greatest tools. And unfortunately, sometimes it comes from those that are closest to us. But understand, when somebody mocks us, they're not mocking us. They're mocking God. They're mocking the name and the person and the gospel of Jesus Christ. Here's the thing. Jesus told us that we would be mocked. He told us that we would be persecuted. He told us that we would suffer on his behalf. I am more concerned when I'm not mocked than when I am. It's almost like when somebody comes against me and somebody's got something to say where they challenge me by virtue of trying to demean me. And that's what it's really about. They just want you to feel stupid. They want you to feel weak. They want you to feel like somehow or another that they are less than they are because you have faith in an almighty God. Yeah, I am weak. Yeah, I do need a God. But the God that I have created me. The God that I have created you. The God that I serve created everything that we see, feel, breathe, touch, and observe. He is the creator of all. Why would I not acknowledge and serve him? Satan is always trying to undermine the plan and the purpose of the people of God. It's interesting. Something that's going on just recently, and you guys may or may not be aware of this, but we've gotten involved with the Child Evangelism Fellowship Organization, which are those that promote within schools what are called the Good News Clubs. The Good News Clubs is a once a week venue where for an hour and a half, 2 hours, we'll go into one of the elementary schools and we will have a Bible club in the school on school property right after school lets out. And we are going to start that in at least one, if not two, and hopefully eventually all three of the schools, the elementary schools here in Dayton, this next coming school semester. Yeah. We're allowed to do that because the Supreme Court made a determination and a decision that we have equal access as well as any other program or club that would go in. So if there's a Boys and Girls Club, if there's a chess club, if there's a choir club, if there's anything, then we have equal access. Now, we've already approached the schools, and we've been given, believe it or not, great reception and great favor to go in and to do this. And we'll be starting at Riverview this next semester, and we'll be there. But the enemy doesn't like it when the people of God put something out. So by virtue of trying to stop that, the enemy now has formulated, and this is pretty well out there, what is now called the After School Satan Club. Not even trying to obscure it. not even trying to call it something else, the Satanists and those that are in favor of trying to thwart anything that is Christian within the schools. And understand, Satan already dominates the schools. So it isn't about wanting more access for the things of Satan. It's simply about not wanting the Word of God in the schools. Now, what they're hoping is going to happen is not that they will get in and be able to actually have an after-school Satan club. That's not really what their hope is. They're hoping that they will be so detested, that they'll be so objectionable by virtue of their charter that they want to bring into the schools, that the schools will deny them access. They want to be denied access so that they can then go and claim protection under the Supreme Court ruling that says religious organizations are allowed into schools and cannot be stopped. The end goal is not to gain access into the school. The end goal is to get the Supreme Court decision reversed so that then the good news clubs with the gospel of Jesus Christ will also have to leave the schools. You see, this is the type of thing that the enemy does. This is the type of mockery. This is the type of calculated and measured type of opposition that he brings to the things and to the Word of God. And guys, we need to be praying against this. Now, in my mind, it's like, go ahead, let them in. Go ahead. I really don't, I'm really hoping that there's not a whole lot of interest in the Satan club. Oh, there'll be some, sadly. But what I know is that where sin abounds, grace abounds more. And if they've got to be there in order for us to be there, then we will go in and pull as many of those kids out of the pit of hell that we can before Satan gets a hold of them. And I don't want to not be there. See, Satan already has got free reign of the schools, man. He's already got it. He doesn't care if he's got more access. He simply doesn't want the Word of God to have access. Hear, O God, for we are despised. Turn the reproach on their own head and give them as plunder to the land of captivity. Do not cover their iniquity and do not let their sin be blotted out from before you, for they have provoked you to anger before the builders. So we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Now, it happened when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, and the Amorites, and the Ashdites heard that the walls of Jerusalem were being restored and the gaps were being closed, that they became very angry. And all of them conspired together to come and attack Jerusalem and create confusion. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God. Because of them, we set a watch against them night and day. Then Judah said, the strength of the laborers is failing, and there is much rubbish that we are not able to build the wall. And our adversary said, they will neither know nor see anything till we come into their midst and we kill them and cause the work to cease. And so it was when the Jews who dwelt near them came, and they told us 10 times, from whatever place you turn, they will be upon you. Therefore, I positioned men behind the lower parts of the wall at the openings, and I set the people according to their families and with their swords and their spears and their bows. And I looked around, and I said to the nobles, to the leaders, and to the rest of the people, do not be afraid. Don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord, great and awesome, and fight for your brethren, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your houses. And it happened when the enemies heard that it was known to us that God had brought their plot to nothing, that all of us returned to the wall, everyone to his work. So it was from that time on that half of my servants worked at construction while the other half held spears. The shields and the bows, they wore armor, and the leaders were behind the house of Judah. An amazing picture of God's people standing against the enemies of God. And folks, understand there's going to be times when we have to stand and fight. And I love this picture, because the enemy is going to be relentless in their attacks and bringing it on. And it says that these guys plotted to come up, and the plot became known. And so what Nehemiah did is he said, all right, I'm going to take half the guys and have them keep building, and I'm going to have the other half of the guys dress out in armor. They're going to stand here, and they're going to protect you guys while you work. You guys keep working. These guys are going to protect. And when God's people turned around into a defensive posture towards the enemy, the enemy stopped coming. The enemy stopped coming. Those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens loaded themselves so that in one hand they worked at construction and with the other hand they carried a weapon. Every one of the builders had his sword girded at his side as he built, and one who sounded a trumpet was beside me. And then I said to the nobles and the rulers and the rest of the people, the work is great and extensive, and we are separated far from one another on the wall. Whenever you hear the sound of the trumpet, rally to us, and our God will fight for us. And so they labored in the work. Half of the men held spears from daybreak until the stars appeared, and at the same time I also said to the people, let each man and his servant stay at night in Jerusalem, that they may be on guard by night and a working party by day. So neither I or my brethren, my servants, nor the men of the guard who followed me took off our clothes, except that everyone took them off to wash them. In order to complete the work, they had to go to some incredible working conditions. 24 hours a day. They'd work all day, and then all night long they would stay in a position of having their weapons nearby in case somebody came to do harm to the wall. They could step up and they could defend it. It says that they stayed there so much that they didn't even change their clothes except for to take them off to wash them. Now, I don't know how that worked, all right? But it surely is a demonstration of God's people stepping up to do that which needed to be done. But what it also does is it gives us this great picture of just how serious the battle is. Of at times that we have to stand together in order to be able to build that which God has placed before us. And guys, I believe that in the recent history of the church, that at some point in time that we as Christians, that we as believers have forgotten that we're in a battle. There's been a lot of churches built in the last 50 or 100 years. There's been a lot of building going on, but there hasn't been a whole lot of defending against the things of the enemy that would infiltrate and taint those buildings. And because of that, I believe that the buildings that are being built and representing God today, many of them are representing Him in such a way that they look like a house of man rather than a house of God. And it's so much of the world has come in. It's as if, oh, we're going to build it, but we're not going to defend against the enemy who wants to come inside. And so while our backs are to the enemy, building that which we're claiming is for God, the enemy is joining in the work and coming in because nobody has turned to face the enemy and to ward him off. And guys, we're at such a time right now. I love this picture. I love this picture of a trowel to build in one hand and a sword to defend in the other. That's where they're at. And guys, I believe that we are in such a time today if we are to build that which God has called us to build. Amen? Is this good stuff? You like this stuff? I love this stuff. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank You.